Have you ever wondered if you could make a window, a dialog box in your game, just from pure ASCII character? Well, I did wonder that, and maybe I'm crazy, but I managed to do it, and I'm gonna show you this week how I managed to do that, and probably why you should not try to replicate what I did. Hey everyone, and welcome to another episode. I'm Ombarus, and I'm happy that this week we're back to a more regular episode, but I do hope that you checked my last week's episode where I was showcasing my game, because I really think it's coming together well, and I got really awesome feedback from all of you guys, and I was really happy to hear all of your feedbacks, and it seems that most of the feedback all turned around the same topic, which is usability. There's a lot of issues with my UI, and I'm kind of happy actually that this was the feedback, because I knew about it. I hadn't spent a lot of time working on the UX, user experience, and it's very important. You should be working from the beginning on the user experience, but there's a good reason why I didn't do that. You see, my game is still kind of half in the prototype stage, and when I was making the prototype, I didn't even know what features I was going to add, and I was testing a lot of different features. Some were removed, some were added, and because of this, it was difficult to design like a whole unified UI system. I just was piling on some features and removing them and changing them. And it's much easier to do if you have a crappy, messy UI to begin with. And that's why, for the most part, I was just adding features and without doing much design. Or did I? Actually, I did do some design. Because when I first started, I was really stuck with this idea that I wanted the UI to feel like the classic roguelike, like Rogue, NetHack, Dwarf Fortress. I wanted some ASCII feeling to my UI. So I spent a lot of time trying to design a beautiful UI using purely ASCII characters. And now that I've been spending a lot of time with it, I a little bit regret my decision. But, you know, I'm stuck with it now, and I do think it looks good, so. So let's start by looking at what you would normally do. Normally, in Godot, you would just create something called the NinePatchRect. What it does is basically it allows you to define areas where you should either stretch or tile your sprite or your background. So I created this super ugly background, and technically, for example, I could just put a label in there. Hello, my friend. And, you know, this would be some kind of dialogue with buttons and stuff like that. And so just to show you an example, I have both of them here. I have this this here as a sprite and this here as a nine patch. And if the thing is square, it looks pretty much the same, right? But the problem is when you start stretching it, because of course your dialogues will have to adjust their size and their shape according to whatever you want to display. So for the sprite, when I start stretching it, you're gonna see that it becomes seriously ugly. But if I do the same thing with the nine patch rec, you're gonna see that everything stays pretty good. Actually, you can see that this here is getting crushed a little bit. But you can even adjust this by choosing if your axis should stretch or tile. And if I choose tile, it should change a little bit. Actually, you see? Now, these markers are staying exactly at the same position all the time. And this is what a nine patch rec does. It just allows you to create very beautiful text window with the look and feel that you want. But that's not what I wanted. When I tried to do it and create it to give it like a text feel, like an ASCII feel, I couldn't get it to work exactly the way I wanted. So what I did instead is I spent a huge amount of time trying to design just the perfect UI using purely ASCII and Notepad. And you have an idea here of what I actually tried to do. So I tried a whole bunch of different design. So, you know, the square like this, with the title and like this, or with a small X at the corner, or dashed, or full, or double, and all these kind of all these kind of designs that I tried. And, you know, I even went on Wikipedia to check the whole Unicode table to try to find characters that I could use to make my dialogue windows look just perfect. And, of course, most of it is just characters, but when you get into the special section, then you start having funky stuff like these kind of weird characters and, you know, these lines and these dots and these circles and this dash, box drawing. So there's a section dedicated to box drawing, but some other elements are also interesting, like, for example, the block elements. So if I wanted to have like a thicker line or something, I could use these block element. I could even have like these light shade, medium shade. So I could even do like the background as a shade like this. And that's very interesting. But that's not all, because since I was going ASCII, I still had to choose the font. And not all fonts are made equal. You might think that any Unicode font will have all the tables of characters, but that's far from the truth. Most fonts only include a subset of all the Unicode possible character. So I had to find fonts that had all the characters I wanted, like these, and that were free for commercial use, but also that were monospaced and kind of looked good. And in the end, I settled for something called the Deja Vu Sans Mono, which looks okay and I think is fine, and it's also free to use for commercials, so it's pretty good. But as you can see, you can choose from a whole lot of different styles and font, but it doesn't necessarily gives you a lot of good results. Actually, there's a lot more fonts that gives me bad results than fonts that give me a good result. And I spent a lot of time looking for the right font that would give me exactly what I wanted. And as you can see, you know, it's hard to find the right one. The initial implementation wasn't too bad, because I know that I'm using a monospace font, so all my characters are exactly always the same height and the same width. Godot allows you to get the size of a single character quite easily, and since my font is monospace, I know that any character will always have exactly the same font's height and font width. So with that, it was a simple matter of just calculating the size of my label and then dividing that by the width of my characters to figure out exactly how many characters I have to print to make my borders. And if you have a look, this thing here is just a label, and I've printed inside the text that I want. If you open it, you can see this is the text that I've printed. And I do it automatically in a script that has the tool tag here, so that it even works when I'm in the editor, so that I can just take this, and when I resize it, then I automatically redraw the text according to how wide my window is or how small my window is. And it works pretty well, and I was pretty happy with this. And I thought this is easy peasy, until I met the bugs, because there's quite a lot of bugs in this implementation. First of all, I'm using text, so I cannot have like a quarter of a character or half a character printed to make my box fit exactly the size of my window. My window is pixel precise, but my box cannot be, and especially on the height, since each character has quite a lot of height, it's a little bit of a problem. As you can see, I can move my window size here, but the box size doesn't change because it has to be an integer of the height of the text. This also has another impact. It means that anything I write inside my box has to follow not the size of the window, but the size of my font. And the fact that the size of my window has to be a multiple of the size of my font is kind of created a whole bunch of problems, because, for example, here I'm trying to center this text inside my box, but because my window is actually a little bit bigger than what my font can allow, then it means that my text is not quite centered. But depending on where I place my box, it will be kind of centered. But as soon as it's centered, pop, I remove a line and then I end up not centered. And also, you'll notice that I have this background to my button here that's black, but this background is filling the whole screen because it doesn't know the size of my label, and it doesn't know that it has to be a multiple of the height of my window. So once again, it can kind of be closed, but then pop, it gets erased again. And then sometimes it's really big and sometimes it's getting really small. And, you know, it doesn't, it never really fits the background. It, the text is never perfectly aligned. And fixing this was actually a really big challenge. But in the end, I did manage to get something kind of working. So as you can see, I have a button here. And even though the box is a little bit bigger than the button because of the font, everything is following and everything is perfectly centered. And it's working pretty well. But I had to do a lot of work to do that. But hopefully, all of this is in the same dialog window base ASCII, and all my buttons, everything in my game, every buttons, every dialog, every window in my game is using the exact same base dialog window ASCII. So it means that anything I change here is right away reflected in all my buttons. So any fix I make, I don't have to copy paste it anywhere. It's all using the same layout. And it also means that it gives a uniformity to my UI that is very important in good user experience. So actually I'm kind of happy with it. And if you look at the code now, as you can see here, I've defined all the characters I'm using for each of my borders. And I have a couple different style I tried, but really the one I prefer is the double one. But for my buttons, I'm using a single one. If you have a look here, my buttons are using single one and my normal dialogues are using double. But this is actually a property that I can just change here. So whoop, now it's single, now it's sticker, and now it's empty. So that's pretty cool. And also automatically, if you add a title, then it's going to create this little demarcation here. I can choose how high I want it to be. And I can add little dialog buttons, OK and cancel. And I can even make it disabled or enabled if I wanted to. But these are all features that I'm slowly, surely adding one after the other on top of everything, which make it that this window is getting more and more complicated, but also more and more flexible. So it's kind of a trade-off. But as you can see here, I'm doing some stuff with calculating how many times I have to repeat each characters. And here I'm calculating the remainder width that it cannot be filled with a whole character. And I'm using this later to offset everything inside my control by this amount. And also for any other elements I would like to add later, then I have this method I added, getFrameSize. And this method is so that anyone that uses my dialog can access this to position his elements perfectly. And honestly, this smells so bad to me because this is breaking all the layout stuff of Godot because I'm doing it by GDescript and I have to do it manually. But, you know, who listens to their little voice in their head anyway that's telling you that everything you're doing is wrong and you're gonna be fucked later on? You know, it's not important. Ignore their little voice in your head and just do it the way you want. And we'll see later if it comes back to bite me. Another bug that I've been having a lot of fun with is when I resize my window, look at what happened to my UI. So it's fine, it's fine, it's fine. And then poof, suddenly, like, as you can see, the background is still looking fine, but why are my characters like kind of offset? And why not all of them? And what's happening exactly? And this seems to pop like for no reason. Look, it's kind of, it's one way, 1 second, and then I move by 1 pixel and poof, everything pops to another way. It didn't look like anything I was doing was wrong. I mean, I'm not changing the font size, I'm not doing anything with my font, and the number of characters is not changing, I'm not redrawing my window, it's still the same number of characters. For example, these buttons are the same size, but for some reason they're like growing and then, you know, changing size and everything is getting misaligned. And I couldn't figure out what was happening and I had to look so hard. I had to actually kind of look in the source code of Godot to figure out which part of the code was handling this font. And then I had to look into commits that were done around this area to lead me to some Reddit comments about issues about font oversampling. And what I figured is that because there's an option by default in the project setting in the rendering quality that's called use oversampling for dynamic fonts. And what this does, as far as I can understand, is that it prints the font at a bigger resolution and then scale it down to give it this beautiful, rounded, soft look. And it does look better when you use oversampling. But the problem with this is that it makes it possible that your font is not exactly the size of a pixel. You might have your font taking not exactly, for example, 4 pixel wide. It might be 4.3 pixel wide. And so when you're printing a lot of characters, it ends up kind of messing up the alignment. And so if I turn this off, then all my problems go away. But it took me a long time to figure out that this was the issue because I didn't know about this checkbox. And this is one of the things when you're doing debugging and you're looking at issues and problem, sometimes you have to dig really deep and you have to have some skill. It takes some serious skills sometimes to figure out what is wrong with your code. But, you know, sometimes you just have to do it and you have to keep looking. And that's what I did. And in the end, well, it might not be the ideal solution because ideally I'd like to use oversampling because it does make the font look better. But I don't think I have the skill required right now to be able to fix it in Godot. So, and you know, disabling oversampling fixes all my issues. So maybe I'm just better off without using font oversampling and hoping you have a big enough screen resolution that you don't notice so much. So guys, that's it for this week. I hope you had fun. If you liked what you see, if you want to see more, don't forget to check my Patreon and try to support me. It really helps and it really means a lot to me. And also, don't forget to subscribe, hit that like button, and see you guys in my next episode. Bye!